Good morning, Eastside, and any of you that may be our guest today online, we are so grateful that you have taken the time to join us at 9:30 and 11 o'clock for what promises to be another great day of worship and celebration. And while we are still somewhat socially isolated and distanced, we are grateful that you have taken time to join us, whether you live across the street or somewhere around the world. Means a lot you've taken time to be with us. I'm going to continue with part four in our series on the Beatitudes today. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they will be filled. We're going to examine what that means today, biblically and literally, and how that has application into your life and mine. I am so grateful that you're here. Enjoy the morning of worship here at Eastside. Make a few comments if you're in a place where you can do that. Encourage us and let us know you're on the team today. What do you say now? Let's worship the Lord together.
Well, today's going to be a great day of worship, and I'm glad that you tuned in. So whether you're on Facebook, our website, or YouTube, you have found Eastside, and you are part of our family today. Today's not only going to be some great hymns, but it's going to be some wonderful choruses as we press into the Lord. So let's ask Him to lead us on today, and let's sing together.
Pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table. I'm gaining every day, though some may dwell where leaves abound, my prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I pray till heaven I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Let's sing that chorus one more time.
Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table land, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground.
Oh, that's our desire today, to see the Lord in a new light, in a new way, as we experience Him. You know, a moment ago before we started the taping, we actually talked about this, that most of us would walk with the Lord for a couple of decades, right? Not that any of us are old. We got saved very young. That's really what the story is here. But we have seen the Lord do a lot of things in our lives and the lives of our family. And just as the Bible says, is that when He is lifted up, He draws people to Himself. And I believe as Christians, that's the same way, isn't it? That when we look to Him in the midst of trouble and trial, that He shows Himself to be real in our lives. You know, John tells the story of a good friend of his that wrote this particular hymn, a friend of his from Canada, and it just reminds us that if we come to Calvary and lay our burdens down, that Jesus is always close and very near. Listen to these words now.
Days are filled with sorrow. Hearts are lonely and drear. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near.
Sing with
with me, friends.
Burdens are lifted at Calvary. 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 Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. So cast your care on Jesus today. Leave your worry and fear. Burdens are Jesus is very near.
Give the Lord your burden today.
Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near.
Oh, he's near today.
Jesus is very near.
Amen. So today, can I encourage you to press into the Lord, give him your burdens, come into his presence with thanksgiving and your heaviness, because he can handle this. God is on your side, and he's called you to be a victor today.
In the presence of Jehovah, God Almighty, Prince of Peace, troubles vanish, hearts are mended in the presence of the King. Hearts are mended in the presence of the King,
and we are standing on all around.
Today, just as we stand in your presence, our mind goes back to that picture in the Old Testament, taking off the sandals in the burning bush, and you were there, just as you are right where we are today. So we pause for a moment. We sang about this, but now we say, will you take our burdens, Lord? You know the things that we keep before you, whether that's a loved one that needs to come to a saving knowledge of you, whether that's a health concern, financial concern. And I'm reminded that your word says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything in prayer and supplication, make our petition known to you. So we, your church, come collectively and individually now. With our prayer list, trusting you and laying them at the foot of the cross in a holy place today. So will you speak to us now as we peer into your word in just a few moments and be reminded of the Beatitudes. In Christ's name we pray.
Hi, my name is Lamar Newton, and I've been a part of the worship team here at Eastside for a little over 4 years. I got acquainted with the church actually through Pastor John's dad, John Hull Sr. He's an old-time evangelist, and I used to go hear him preach many, many times in my life. I've had an opportunity to play with several different groups. I've traveled professionally a couple of times in my life, and I've been gone a lot on the weekends for many, many years, and I could have not have done this without the blessing and the prayers of my sweet wife, Vicky.
Yeah, as you see, I've been around the block a time or two. There's the first group I ever played with. This is a picture of the first professional group I ever played with, and luckily they were here right in Atlanta.
I feel like I've made a connection with the people when just a couple of weeks after I was here, many people come up to me and say, thank you so much for playing this song, or thank y'all for singing this song, because I have not heard this song in 40 years. And so I think that's the uniqueness of our legacy service, is that we do songs that are familiar to everyone. And no matter what kind of music there is out there, we always seem to come back to the hymns of the church. And I'm thankful for that. And I'm so glad to be a part of the church here today.
Well, good morning and welcome to the Bible teaching time of our worship service here at Eastside. Thank you so much for being with us. We know you have lots of online worship service options these days, and for you to join us means so very, very much. So whether you're joining us from the neighborhood around the church here in Marietta, Georgia, or you're watching somewhere around the world or somewhere in between, again, welcome. We are delighted to have you here. Now, you're joining us today as we are in the midst of a series on the Beatitudes. That's the introductory passage of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount that he proclaimed from Matthew chapter 5 and beyond. I'd like to encourage you today as we look at the fourth Beatitude found in Matthew chapter 5. Let's read up to verse 5 and 6 and discover where we are so that we can now begin to look at a new beatitude as Jesus talks about those that are happy because they hunger and thirst for righteousness, and as a result, they will be filled. What do you say you take your Bibles and join with me, would you? Matthew chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. It says, "Now when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. And his disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, 'Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth.'" And then we come to the fourth beatitude, our topic today. Jesus said, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." You know, there is nothing that consumes us, if you will. There is no basic need in our lives beyond breathing moment after moment. No basic need greater to us than food and water. That of trying to conquer our hunger, try to conquer our thirst. They are driving forces inside the body. And what Jesus does is he uses this fourth beatitude by comparing these driving forces within the body that should be driving forces within the souls of his disciples. Now, Jesus was speaking to a crowd of people there on the Sea of Galilee who had seen generations of leaders come into their land, into their territory, and take over, if you will, have a power grab and gain authority. In fact, as Jesus is speaking there in first century Israel, it is the Roman Empire that is dominating the Jewish people and the Jewish nation. Prior to that, it was the Greeks that came in and they ruled with great authority. Prior to that, in that part of the world, it was the Medes and Persians who came and conquered. And prior to that, it was the Babylonians. And even prior to that, there were certain bad Jewish kings, kings of Israel, who had inappropriate desires and motives to try to take over and exercise great authority. These people were living in a land where there had been leaders who had demonstrated a tremendous hunger, a tremendous thirst, or had a tremendous appetite of power and for power. Now, when you search the scriptures, you discover that the first power grab in all of history was performed by Lucifer, an angel that became a fallen angel because of his power grab to become like God. In fact, in detail, the prophet Isaiah talks about how Lucifer desired to usurp God's power, to usurp God's authority. And God's response was to throw Lucifer into a pit to be damned forever. God takes seriously when someone tries to usurp his power, tries to take his place. Always remember, Lucifer hungered and thirsted after power. We come back here to Matthew chapter 5, and Jesus teaches on the banks of the Sea of Galilee that the deepest desire for the disciple, the greatest hunger for the follower of Jesus, the greatest thirst for the Christ follower should not be power. It should not be praise. It should not be pleasure. But the greatest hunger and thirst should be to desire righteousness. As Jesus said directly, to have a hunger and a thirst for righteousness. Now, in this Jewish audience to whom Jesus was speaking, if any of them knew their history as a people, they could point back in Jewish history and know that they were a part of people, at least their ancestors, who had experienced famine and hunger and deprivation of food or with no food at a high level. In fact, when the Jews were slaves in Egypt, when Joseph served as Pharaoh's prime minister, there was a period, Genesis tells us, where those people, Egyptians and Jews, experienced 7 years of famine, 7 years without crops. And Joseph, in his leadership, had tried to set aside a plan by which he could feed the people during a period of famine, as he had tried to collect more food and place it in silos and containers and storage centers during times of plenty. You see, this was an audience there in Galilee that in their history, they knew something about their ancestors and famine. You may recall that we were just in the book of Ruth, if you've been with us, before we started Beatitudes in the book of Ruth. All the narrative of Ruth started in Ruth chapter 1 because Bethlehem was experiencing a famine. And Naomi and her husband and sons moved out of Bethlehem into a land called Moab, and there they would meet Ruth, and the narrative would continue. But all of that story of grace, all of that story of the messianic aspects of Jesus Christ coming through that lineage and line, through future prophecies, all of that began because of a family that escaped Bethlehem because they were in famine. If you look at history, you discover that there have been times when this world has been rocked by famine, not having any food whatsoever. Some 400 years before Jesus is standing before this audience in Galilee in Matthew chapter 5, the Roman Empire had experienced a great famine. Fast forward years later to England in the year 1005, there was a mammoth famine in that nation. During the medieval ages, the medieval era of several hundred years, historians tell us that in England alone, during those centuries of the medieval times, that there were 95 different famines which occurred in England, and some 75 different famines that occurred in France. England experienced famines, or pardon me, Europe, greater Europe experienced famines in the 9th century, the 11th century, and the 12th century. Fast forward even more to our contemporary world of the 20th century. Historians and statisticians tell us that in the 20th century alone, between 70 million and 100 million people died from famine, malnutrition. 30 million of that 70 to 100 million people who died of starvation were in China. If you come a little bit later into the 20th century, into the 1980s, we discovered famines were occurring in Africa, specifically in the nation of Ethiopia. And over a period from 1983 to 1985, 1.2 million people died of starvation. They hungered to death. We come right now to the year 2020, and according to the World Food Program Organization, statistics are reported back in April that reports that the world is facing famines of a biblical proportion due to COVID-19. In fact, this organization lists 10 countries that presently, collectively, have more than 1 million people that are on the verge of starvation. So when Jesus is talking about hungering and thirsting, if you did a word study of those two words, it's the desperation hunger. It's the desperation thirsty. It's the kind of thing you experience if you're a poor soul during a period of famine. And what happens when a person is hungry and when a person is thirsty, it's all consuming. They can only focus on trying to get some food or trying to get some water. Through the years, mission organizations have created relief organizations to try to help people around the world in their plight. You and I support organizations like that on a regular basis. And they are there to offer food and medicine to people who can't really even think about their souls, because we first need to be able to think about their stomachs and their health in order to get them in a position where they can hear about the love of Jesus Christ and the life-changing message of the gospel. We want to share the gospel with everyone, but we also realize that there is a need as gospel witnesses to care for those that are hungry, for those that are thirsty. And in verse 6, Jesus speaks, does he not? Look at what he says. In verse 6, he says, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled." Now, if you've been in this series, you know that we've been saying week after week that you need to think of the phrases, the happy are, the such and such, for they will such and such. You need to think of those phrasings in two pictures. The first picture is where Jesus says, blessed are, happy are, and then he talks about the inner condition of that man or woman, the inner condition. Blessed are, and if they are that way, then they will, etc. They will experience, which is the second picture, the blessings which will flow. Jesus says here, this is so important, he says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. That's the inner condition. The blessing which flows will be that they will be filled, more in our terminology, they will be satisfied. When we were created by the Lord, when we were made in his image at birth, even that before, created in the womb, we also had within us an emptiness, a spiritual emptiness. Some have called it a God-sized vacuum. We all grow up with a spiritual sense of need, of wandering, a void, that we are searching for something significant in our lives. Now, as we grow physically over time, here's what we discover. As we grow physically, we have a physical desire to pursue food and water. That begins with perhaps our mother's milk. It transitions into milk and formula, and then into soft food, and then into food and beverage that becomes a part of our daily routine of eating and drinking. That all comes what? Out of a physical desire. But we do not have, when we are born, if you will, a spiritual desire toward what Jesus is talking about, righteousness. Jesus is talking here about the spiritual realm. He says, blessed or happy are those who hunger and thirst in the spiritual realm, for they shall be filled or satisfied. Now, here's what we know. It is coming to faith in Jesus Christ as Savior that fills that God-sized vacuum. You ask Jesus to come into your life, and the Holy Spirit comes in and fills you with Himself, His glory, His person. And that is the beginning of what happens to satisfy that spiritual hunger and that spiritual thirst that we've longed for so long. And so for those that are there on that hillside, for those that are sitting there and listening to our Savior say these words of the Beatitudes, happy are this and happy are they that are doing that. Jesus is talking to a group of people who literally had been hungry for leadership. They had been hungry for a leader. And as I have shared in preceding messages, these people were looking at Jesus as a potential political candidate to change their plight. They were looking at someone who could be a political, yes, but also maybe even a spiritual leader. Maybe this was the Messiah who could lead them out of their terrible plight of being oppressed by the Roman Empire and prior to that other dominant powers. But Jesus turns everything upside down. And as they are looking for some amazing political leader, Jesus is making it very, very clear. He says, those who follow me, and watch this very carefully. He says, those who follow me don't pursue power, but they pursue righteousness. Happy are those who follow me, who hunger and thirst after righteousness. They will be the people who will be filled. Jesus speaks of satisfying a spiritual appetite. And to those unhappy people, those people that were in misery, so many of them had been following him according to the end of chapter 4 because they were plagued with disease or demonic power, and they were just miserable and such an unhappy collection of people. Jesus says to them that pursuing righteousness is a key to happiness, and it is central to satisfaction. Now you go back through very, very quickly, and you see again in verse 3, Jesus says, happy are the humble. What? Happy are the humble. We are people who look and see and think that happiness is when you have great power and you have great authority and you have great pride and you have prestige. No, Jesus says in verse 3, happy are the humble, poor in spirit, who realize that they don't have an ability to save themselves, who realize they don't have the ability to forgive themselves, who realize they don't have the ability to do anything outside the power of God. Blessed are the poor in spirit, Jesus says. Happy are the humble. And then Jesus goes on and continues to turn everything upside down from what the world system says. Jesus says in verse 4, happy are the sad. Happy are they that mourn, that realize that they are hurting and that others are hurting. Happy are they that mourn, he says there in verse 4, for they are the ones who will experience comfort, relief. He then says, as we shared last week, happy are the meek. Happy are those that have power under control, not demonstrating and lording over and showing off their power and how much they have and how much they can do and how much they know and how well they can talk. He says, happy are the meek. And then here in verse 6, happy are the hungry and the thirsty. The hungry and the thirsty, Jesus says, does this. They that belong to me are hungry and thirsty for righteousness. And so the question before us today would be, hey, John, what is righteousness? Jesus said to hunger and thirst, but what is it we're supposed to hunger and thirst for, this thing called righteousness? Well, righteousness itself really begins with the very attributes of God. God is righteous. He is only right. He can never be or do anything wrong. God is always right. It's in his core. It's his essence. It's his being. It's his attribute. God is righteous. The word righteous is a first cousin to the word holy. God is holy. God always was holy, always will be holy. God is holy. God will not be more holy tomorrow than he is today. God is not more holy today than he was yesterday. God is holy. That is an echo of the idea or concept of righteousness. You could think as well as the idea of God's justice. the justice of God, or that God is just. A lot of crying in our land for justice, and I understand so much of that, and trying to learn more. Some people are not pleased when justice is done according to human laws, but here's what we do know, that God is righteous and just, and God is holy, and when God declares something or executes his justice, it is always right. It is inarguable because it is holy, it is pure, it is right. That's the righteousness of God. One commentator that I read this week said this, I thought it was so strong, quote, "There is no law that is violated by anything of his nature. There is no law that is violated by anything of his nature," end of quote. God is righteous. The psalmist in Psalm 11, verse 7 said this, "The Lord is righteous." When Daniel was writing in Daniel 9, verse 7, he speaks and he says, "To you, O Lord, belongs righteousness." In the New Testament, as the apostles are building the New Testament churches in Asia Minor, Paul says, "The Lord will judge the world in righteousness." One more time in the Psalms, in Psalm 19, verse 9, the psalmist says, "The rules of the Lord are true and righteous altogether." Righteous. Jesus comes along, and what's he say? He says, "Happy are you who hunger and thirst after righteousness." You're going to be satisfied. You're going to be filled. Well, when you hunger for God's righteousness, what does that mean in 2020? What does that mean as we live in this culture today? When you're hungering and thirsting after righteousness as a follower of Jesus, that means that you are hungering after God, thirsting after God's word. You are desiring and wanting God's precepts in your life. You are desiring or pursuing God's heart. You're wanting God's will. You're wanting God's peace. You're wanting God's voice to speak into your life. You're wanting God's glory to take place all around you. That is just a thimbleful of what it means to hunger and thirst after righteousness. And I want to note this for you as you study this, to understand that this hunger and this thirst is not just a one-time thing. In fact, it is written here, as all of these actions are in the Beatitudes, it's written here in the idea of continual action. It's a present participle in grammar. It's the idea of a continuation, continually to hunger, continually thirst for or after righteousness. Jesus says, "Happy are those of you who follow me if you will continually hunger and thirst after righteousness. You will be filled." And then the interesting thing to me, practically speaking, is that the more you hunger, the hungrier you get for God, for righteousness, you'll be satisfied. But then that satisfaction doesn't last long because you just want more. You can't get enough. When you hunger and thirst for righteousness, the more the longing is met, the more you want that longing in your life. Just give me more about God's righteousness. Give me more of God's word. Tell me more about Jesus. Teach me more about the Holy Spirit. Teach me more about salvation. I want to have that in my life. And I find in the midst of that satisfaction, I'm enjoying it. But man, even after that, I want more. I want satisfaction that leads to more satisfaction that leads to more satisfaction. And it's all about God's glory. It's all about God's grace. It's all about God. It's all about God's righteousness. And if that sounds somewhat peculiar to you, please don't let it be, because all we have to do is to look in the scriptures, and we look at Moses in the book of Numbers, chapter 33, and Moses, who was close to God, said, "God, please show me more of your glory." He had a longing for more. Think about David. He had a thirst for more. David said in the Psalms, as the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longs or pants or is thirsty for you. David had a thirst for more. Moses longed for more. And then Paul in Philippians, he just hungered for more. He just said, I want to know him better. I want to know the power of his resurrection in my life. I want to experience the fellowship of his sufferings. I just want to know him more. Now, the Bible teaches, if you will, a twofold application when it comes to this issue of knowing more or being hungry and thirsting for righteousness. Twofold application. The first application is for the unbeliever. That is to hunger and thirst for salvation. Has that happened to you? Have you had in your life that moment where you had a hunger and thirst to be changed by Jesus Christ, who only has the power to change you, who only has the power to save you, to forgive your sins? Can you remember in your life a time when you hungered and thirst, perhaps for the very first time, for Jesus Christ to change your life and to offer his forgiveness of sin? The first beatitude, again, says, blessed are the poor in spirit. The idea of the poor in spirit is I don't have the ability to save myself. I am in poverty and sin. I don't have the capacity to forgive myself. I am poor in spirit. Happy are the poor in spirit. Happy is the person that recognizes they can't save themselves. And happy is the person who will hunger and thirst after righteousness. It begins at that first time at salvation when you pray to receive Jesus, ask for the forgiveness of sin. Have you done that? 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ died for your sins. 3 days later, he rose from the dead. He lives today and forevermore. Is that a reality in your life? Today, if you are hungry and thirsty for Jesus Christ, he can change your life, repent of your sins, confess him as Lord, ask him to save you, and he will save you now. That's the first, if you will, of the twofold application of hungering and thirsting for righteousness. It's for the unbeliever to hunger and thirst for salvation. But then there is a second application, and that is for the believer. And it moves from the area of salvation into the believer, the person who knows Christ, to have a continual hunger and thirst for Jesus in your walk with him as a Christian, as a disciple, through the process of sanctification. Sanctification. You see, once you come to know in Christ, you come to know Christ, then there's that hunger and desire to grow in grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus. Now, that word sanctification is a big word, but it basically means to be set apart, to be cleansed, to be separated. And that's what happened at salvation. We were separated from our sin because of what Christ did on the cross for us. He saved us. We could not save ourselves. But after we are in this world knowing Jesus, a disciple of Jesus, there's a responsibility to stay hungry and to stay thirsty, and that is sanctification. That is growing in Jesus. And when you come to know Jesus, you should never stop hungering and thirsting for him. Those of you that have been at Eastside for a while have heard me say, and said it a number of times, a lot of places I've spoken. I've said that I've all over the world when I've spoken and had the opportunity and joy to preach about Jesus Christ, and it could be a salvation message or a leadership lesson or something about equipping the saints. After it's over, I've never had a Christian come up to me and say, "Hey, John, listen, you talked too much about Jesus today. You really did. You just went on and on and on about Jesus. Please, keep it down about Jesus." That has never happened to me before an audience or a congregation of Christians, whether it was thousands or in a group or in a circle of Bible study. You see, the Christian, the Christ follower, the disciple, has a hunger and a thirst for righteousness, which means literally, you just can't get enough about Jesus Christ. You just can't get enough about the Word. You just can't get enough about truth. You just can't get enough of what He is doing and desiring to do in your life. You just can't get enough of just discussing what it is that God is teaching you. You just can't get enough of how to be equipped to help other people, to serve the poor, to care for the oppressed, to take the gospel to the world. You just want more. That's a healthy appetite spiritually. We sing, give me more, more, more about Jesus, more of His saving fullness, see, more of His love, more of His blood, who died for me. We always want more. And Jesus echoes this even in the end of this chapter, Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, which is still a part of the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus says, be perfect or mature as I am mature. That's what He tells His disciples. You need to be mature as I am mature. You need to be fully grown disciple of Jesus Christ. You need to hunger and thirst for righteousness, and that's how you get grown up in the faith. That's how you become mature. It's by hungering and thirsting for righteousness to be more like Him. Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15 and 16, you're called. As Christ followers, you're called to be holy, so be holy. And God says, be holy because I am holy. And Jesus here, in Matthew chapter 5, look at it. He tells them, He says, hey, people who are so unhappy, here is happiness. Here is happiness. You who are hungry for leadership, here is filling. Here's how to be full. You that are so dissatisfied and so disgruntled, here is satisfaction. Hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they that do that will be happy and they will be filled, they will be satisfied. So can I just ask you, how are you doing on this? How are you doing, Christ follower, in the area of hungering and thirsting for righteousness? I know some of you can't wait when COVID eases enough that you can go back to your favorite restaurant in town and you can hunger and thirst after your favorite food and beverage items. Jesus is talking to you and me as Christ followers. He's saying we need to hunger and thirst after righteousness. Are you hungry for righteousness? Are you thirsty for righteousness? The disciple of Jesus in an unhappy world, and that's where we are right now. We're in an unhappy country. The follower of the Lord Jesus Christ in an unhappy culture knows that true happiness is found in righteousness. It is not found in power, financial or political. It is not found in praise of self. And it is not found in pleasure, be it sexual, be it any kind of pleasure that even is appropriate. I read about a hamburger in a town called Clearfield, Pennsylvania. The hamburger is 6 pounds of ground beef and 5 pounds of fixings. It costs $30, and on average, it takes about 3 hours to eat it. It's amazing what some people will do with food, isn't it? Do you remember the wrestler and the actor, Andre the Giant? He was 7 feet 4 inches tall, weighed hundreds and hundreds of pounds, mammoth human being. It is documented that at one sitting, after dinner. He could drink, listen to this, he could drink in one sitting between 120 and 150 bottles of beer. It's amazing what people will do with drink. But here comes Jesus. And he says, if you want to be happy in an unhappy world, if you want to find fulfillment and satisfaction in a world that is filled with longings and expectations, here's how you find it. You hunger and thirst after righteousness. And if you do that, you will be filled. And that is to hunger and thirst after righteousness. I want to encourage you right now to join me in prayer. I want to pray for those today who may be close to Jesus but not have come to him as Savior, that this would be the day that you hunger and thirst for him and that you would come to him through his righteousness and receive his righteousness in your own life. And I want to pray for believers, people like me and my friends who know Christ as Savior, that we would hunger and thirst on a daily basis to grow in Christ, that we might be able to serve him well and experience that satisfaction too. Join me in prayer, would you? Father, today I pray for anyone who is watching today who is not sure that they know Jesus as Savior. I pray that right now, right where they are, they will bow, humble themselves, and realize that they are poor in spirit, that they cannot save themselves. But if they will humble themselves, repent of their sins, and recognize what Jesus has done on the cross, what Jesus did through the empty tomb, they will believe on the Lord Jesus and confess their sin, Jesus will come in. Thank you for those right now that are responding to that hunger, to that thirsting for the first time. And then, Father, for those who are watching today who know Jesus, consider themselves disciples of Jesus, I pray that you would continue to cultivate within us a genuine hunger and desire to grow in Christ, that we just want to know more, that we'd be genuinely interested in what the Bible has to say, that we'd be genuinely interested in what your glory is all about, that we'd be genuinely interested in seeing how to see the application of Scripture into real time as we live in this society in 2020. Just continue to grow us. Help us to pursue righteousness. May that sanctifying power continue to set us apart as your people living in a land where we have around us so many challenges and so many who do not believe. Help us to pursue your righteousness so that we can give you glory, that we can point people to you as the only way to heaven. Grant us that grace, I pray. Thank you today for the reminders of Jesus in the Beatitudes that are blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you and thanks for watching.